So hi everyone online and welcome. So this is a joint seminar between the TIA Centre and Warwick Health GIP and the Cancer Centre. I'm really excited to have Professor Azra Raza come here today from a university in New York. So before we, I'm going to pass over to Fayez to give an introduction. But before then, I just wanted to lay out the, tell everyone about the layout of today's meeting. So we're going to have about a 5 to 10 minute introduction from Fayez, and then we're going to have a 45 to 50 minute talk from Azra. And then we'll have a 15-minute questions and answer session. So if anyone's got any questions during the talk, could they please write them down and say them until the end rather than asking during the talk? That'd be fantastic, thank you. And then following that, we're gonna have about a 20-minute discussion on collaboration. We've got this room booked over here for a while longer, so 4 p.m. So if that overruns, then that's fine. So brilliant, thank you very much. I will pass you over to Fayez.
Yeah. Thank you, Adam. And thanks for all your help in making these arrangements. And so I'm just going to start with how I got to know Professor Azra Raza. And it starts with a Urdu poem. And I'm going to recite some bits of it. So it goes like, Khabare tahayyure ishq sun, na junu raha na pari rahi, na to tu raha na to main raha, jo rahi so be khabari rahi. I was introduced to Professor Raza through her wonderful explanation of this beautiful 18th century Urdu poem on how love never ceases to amaze. And in addition to her poetic and literary abilities, what amazed me is how she views her scientific pursuit of understanding cancer as an act of love. Professor Raza is the Chan Soon-Shiong Professor of Medicine and Director of the Myelodysplastic Syndrome, MDS Center at Columbia University. She has held positions at Roswell Park Comprehensive Cancer Center, University of Cincinnati, Rush University, and UMass, as well as the Cancer Moonshot Initiative. Raza's research work focuses on MDS and acute myeloid leukemia. Her work has led to the identification of the underlying causes of MDS pathology, as well as development of genomic biomarkers for MDS based on the tissue bank of cancer patients collected by her. Her recent book, The First Cell and the Human Cost of Pursuing Cancer to the Last, discusses how our strategy of tackling cancer needs to adapt to be more effective. In addition to her scientific research published in top-tier journals, she has also written literary works such as the two books on the 19th century Urdu poet Maestro Ghalib. I'm very grateful to her for her graciousness in accepting my out-of-the-blue invite to her to present her research work and discuss future collaborations opportunities with the Tissue Image Analytics Center, the Warwick Cancer Center, and the Warwick Health GRP. I'm very grateful, Professor Raza. Thank you for your kindness. I'll be handing over to you for your talk now. And thanks for everyone in the room and online who's joined us today for this seminar.
Thank you very much, Fayez. Thank you, Adam, for all your help throughout. And thanks to everyone who is on this Zoom meeting today. I'm deeply grateful for this opportunity to present my work. I only wish that I was present in person, which was generously offered by Fayez and Nasir for me to travel. But unfortunately, I somehow couldn't do it right now. I hope to come back. Adam, may I share my screen?
Yeah, please go ahead. Okay. And just a reminder for everyone that's just came in and for everyone online, if we could leave the questions for the Q&A session at the end. Thank you very much.
Can you see my slide?
Yes, we can see everything. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just going to dive right into the work I wanted to present today. So beginning with what I do is that I see 30 to 40 cancer patients in my clinic every week. So I'm a very active hands-on oncologist. I have been supervising a basic research lab for the past 35 years, which has been well funded by government and philanthropic as well as industry resources. But I think my claim to knowing a lot about cancer equally rests upon the fact that my husband, who was the head of the cancer center at the University in Chicago, died of the very disease leukemia that he had dedicated his life to cure after a 5-year long battle. So I stood on both sides of the bed for those 5 long years, of course. And so my perspective on this dreadful disease is something I don't wish even on an enemy. Let me just begin by showing you where I'm coming from through the case of Andrew. In July of 2016, he developed tingling in his right arm. He started to exercise more, weakness developed. He was taken to the emergency room. He was quadriplegic within hours. The neurosurgeons could only remove 90% of the 9-centimeter large glioblastoma multiforme, the deadliest brain tumor known to mankind. Now, from this moment on, because we left 10% of the tumor behind, all his treating oncologists knew that the prognosis is hopeless. Yet what followed? Extensive surgeries, placement of a shunt, intensive rounds of aggressive chemo, radiation, immune manipulation, more chemo, more radiation, more immune therapies. He suffered unbearable toxicities of each, but the tumors continued to grow. Alas, we lost Andrew exactly 16 months from diagnosis. He was 23 years old. We failed Andrew. How badly we failed this poor boy. Oh. He had the most painful death imaginable, which I witnessed firsthand at many levels, because Andrew was my daughter Shahrazad's best friend since school. He was not her boyfriend because our Andrew was gay. In his senior year of college, he went to Paris for fashion design. He comes back and develops that weakness in the arm, and in 16 months of tortured existence, he dies. How many times my daughter called me in the middle of the night saying, "Mommy, you're supposed to help cancer patients. You're not helping Andrew." There was not one thing I could do to help this boy. Was it cruel to his Andrew and his mother keep suggesting ineffective agents, which we know at best would give him additional few weeks? What were the alternatives? Enjoy whatever time he had instead of vomiting his guts out, but then the tumors would grow. Death from cancer is the most painful death, especially when the tumors are growing inside your skull. Was honesty even a choice with Andrew? 22-year-old, we are telling him you're going to die of cancer or die of treatment. These are your two choices. Why are these the only choices in 2023 today is what I'm asking. It's not just a case of Andrew and glioblastoma. Look at the age-adjusted mortality. In 2023 is the same as in 1930. Sure, there is an incline followed by a decline, but this parallels the rise and fall in smoking. So most of the decline, the 1% annual decrease in cancer mortality, is not from some great treatments we have developed. It's preventive measures, anti-obesity and anti-smoking campaigns being up front and center. Yes, it's true, we are curing a lot of cancers, but only because they're diagnosed early. Mostly with surgery, chemo, and radiation. Yes, we are diagnosing them, but then with what? / poison burn. Where are the great treatments that we have been promising since 1970 onwards, or 71 when President Nixon declared war on cancer? I'm afraid that $1 trillion in research later, 95% experimental trials fail today. The 5% that succeed should have failed because they only improve the median survival by 2.1 months for a fraction of patients. This is why I wrote my book, The First Cell and the Human Costs of Pursuing Cancer to the Last. So we are investing 90% resources in pursuing the last cancer cell, mostly in mice. This book is an expression not of my anger, but my deep frustration. Over 4 million papers have been published in cancer research. First of all, the majority are not even reproducible. Look, I can't make up these numbers. They're so dreadful. And we still don't understand the basic mechanisms involved in initiation and progression of cancer. Thousands of clinical trials are being done. Over 3,000 right now in America alone targeting checkpoint inhibition alone, just one target. Do we really need 3,000 trials, each of them costing $150 to $200 million? But it's just because every sponsor thinks that if they can meet their statistical endpoint, which is giving a marginal improvement, as I said, by 2.1 months in survival for 30% patients, then they have $1 billion profit a year. So my question is, why is there such a staggering disconnect between hundreds of billions of dollars spent on understanding cancer and so little benefit by the bedside? How is it helping our patients? And it's at the cost of unbearable physical and financial toxicity. I talk at length in the book about the financial toxicity, which is that 42% of all Americans who are diagnosed today with any kind of cancer will be completely bankrupt in 2 years. 42% of patients diagnosed with cancer. That's a huge number. So just this was to lay down the background for you about where we are. Do not be taken in by people telling you we have a cure for cancer. Sure, we have helped cancer patients. We have made a progress in understanding, but it's too little too late, really. The majority of most common cancers are killing the way they were killing 100 years ago. So since the 1970s, we've subscribed to a reductionist model that these are random mutations that accumulate in genes over age and time. And then one of these happens in a vital gene due to just random DNA copying errors. So there are these mutated genes that produce mutated proteins that cause cells to misbehave. And if we have one gene, one abnormal protein, we can find one magic bullet to cure cancer. Well, it worked exactly in one cancer. But that one cancer, chronic myeloid leukemia, seemed to validate the paradigm about this one mutation, one cancer. There are 200 types of cancers. Only one out of 200 has been helped. For the rest, we need to consider a new model, really. So my contention has been to focus on the first cell, not the last. And I want everyone to know that I have been very consistent since the 1980s in my hypothesis. I started by studying acute myeloid leukemia. Very quickly, it became apparent to me that this disease is so malevolent that in my lifetime, there is unlikely to be any cure. And sadly, I was right, because today in 2023, I am using the same two drugs. The same two drugs called 7 and 3, because 7 days of one and 3 days of another. I was using 7 and 3 in 1977. Today, the first line of treatment for AML is still 7 and 3. So I was correct in my assessment more than 35 years ago. At that point, I started to think the only way that we are able to do something about cancer is if it is diagnosed early. Well, leukemias are a problem because by the time we diagnose, they're all over the place, unlike solid tumors. So I said, I'll have to find people who are at risk of getting leukemia before they develop this disease, kind of an intermediate state. And those are the patients who are called pre-leukemia. They just drop their blood counts and have a clonal proliferation in the marrow, and then a third of them develop leukemia. I said, wow, this is the disease I should focus on, because hopefully I could intercept before it becomes this end stage monstrosity. And this is how I turned my attention to studying the pre-leukemic condition, MDS, and following the patients till they develop leukemia and try to really see what causes this kind of a phase transition from pre-leukemia to leukemia. At this time in the 1980s, I also made up my mind that if I'm going to study cancer in humans, I'm going to study human tissue. So I started a tissue repository in 1984. Today, I have more than 60,000 samples of marrows, blood, bone marrow biopsies, CD34 positive cells, normal T cells, etc., etc. And these samples from patients have been longitudinally obtained in a serial manner as the disease is progressing from pre-leukemia to leukemia. And not a single cell has been contributed by another oncologist. I see the patients myself. I do the bone marrows myself to this day. I draw the blood myself. Why? Because as soon as you say it's research, then I have to pay for everything. Nobody supports this kind of a repository. Now, the idea is that I need to do multi-omics on serial samples to identify what caused the appearance of the first cell in the first place. And that's what we are doing now. Let me show you one example of how we have used the tissue repository. For example, anemia, a low hemoglobin, is the most common finding in patients who have pre-leukemia or MDS. But no one really understands what is causing this anemia. So we decided to interrogate cellular and molecular basis of anemia, which is present in 90% of the patients. And I wanted to study what are the defects in erythropoiesis, not in mice who never get MDS, who never get AML. We push something, we damage their marrow to cause anemia and think it is basically the anemia of MDS, which is completely wrong. So we decided to study directly human samples for defects in erythropoiesis. Now, erythropoiesis in humans is a very well orchestrated program, which goes from hematopoietic stem cells to committed myeloid progenitors to all these stages. Blast forming unit, erythroid, colony forming unit, erythroid, pro-erythroblast, early basophilic, late basophilic, polychromatic, orthochromatic blasts, erythroblasts, and then eventually reticulocyte, and then it exudes the nucleus to become an erythrocyte or red blood cell. So these are the progenitor stages, and this is called terminal erythroid differentiation from pro-erythroblast stage to the orthochromatic stage. And these are very well defined in that one pro-erythroblast will become 2 early, 4 late, 8, 16, and then 32. So this is how it progresses. This terminal erythroid differentiation is, we call it TED, T-E-D, terminal erythroid differentiation. So along with my colleagues at the New York Blood Center, we developed a technique to do for characterization of these cells at different stages by flow cytometry. And just want to show you an example of this. We can now tell you that here are cells in the prostate. These are cell in early basophilic. So all these just based on the way the different stains we gave to the cells. And so when I began to study the TED samples, human samples for terminal erythroid differentiation from MDS patients, what I found was that in the majority of patients, you can see all the stages of TED. These are different patients I'm showing you, okay? So there are 5 patients I'm showing you that they have cells present in each stage and then the final red blood cells here. Now, but a third of the patients we saw just didn't show anything up here. Nothing, they're blank. First, we thought this is a technical error. I spent years trying to solve this, but it turns out it's not a technical error, it's real. They just don't go through these stages. So then we started to look at what is their clinical significance. It turns out that at every level of the disease, people who don't have terminal erythroid differentiation basically die very quickly. They just die. The others can have a longer survival, but if a patient doesn't have TED, it's very bad news. So we published all our findings some years back. Then we wanted to develop a transcriptomic signature and see whether we can identify molecular differences and deregulated pathways between TED and no TED. Can we develop a gene expression profile which would differentiate between the two groups? So remember, highly expressed erythropoiesis show significant expression changes associated with survival. So we have the TED group and the no TED here. And you can see the survival difference, and you can see the difference in their gene expression profile. And a 50 gene signature actually very accurately was able to classify patients very clearly. So then I filed for a patent, which has been granted to me now for this genetic signature. I just gave you this example to see how well we have been using our tissue repository to investigate and explore the pathology of the disease I'm studying. And now a machine learning algorithm has been trained on a 3-gene expression to predict TED status very accurately. And I was thinking that this is one thing we could do together, is now I have a patent on this. But then to find the TED and no TED information, I have to do a painful bone marrow and flow cytometry and then expression profile. But then every patient has also been studied for many simple markers in the blood, like the total blood count, the red cell shape, size, volume, etc. I mean, there are hundreds of parameters on each patient. My idea is, can AI be trained on these simple clinical parameters that we can get from blood and see are anything associated with TED or no TED, which the AI can tell, which we can't tell? So instead of elaborate interrogation of marrow samples, can we simply use a few drops of blood to get equally accurate information? And we have all the data. All you have to do is apply your AI to train your platform on. Other collaborative projects related to just this part is that pathologists also give us percentage of the various stages of TED. For example, 20% cells in this patient are in pro-erythroblast, 10% in early, 12% in late, et cetera, et cetera. So we can use, and I have on thousands of patients, all this information that the pathologist read, but then can AI be trained on these numbers to predict TED and no TED status? So now I'm saying, okay, we don't have to do TED or no TED at all. We just go to the pathology report and simply say. Now, pathologists can't tell us based on those numbers at all, whether it's TED or no TED. And in the paper I published, I showed that blindly I locked a pathologist in a room and gave them tons of biopsies to look at and asked them, can they tell which patient would be TED and on which patient would be no TED just from the biopsies? They did all their counts, they couldn't do it. Now, I have done something with Regeneron, which is a company that's dedicated to genomic studies in America. And Regeneron has done whole SNPs, whole genome SNPs, which is single nucleic acid peptide change. But the thing is that any mutation that's there, whether it is in the exome or intron, exon or intron, will now be available. So these data are also available. They're in the cloud with us. Whole genome SNPs on the entire tissue repository is available. Think of this. This is petabytes of data that's available. So now, That was just an example I wanted to give about the use of the tissue repository and the kinds of things we have been doing already with it. Now coming back to my quest for finding the first cell. What is the genesis of cancer and carcinogenesis, in other words? Here's my hypothesis, that it's not a random event that causes cancer to appear. It's cancer is too well managed a disease with specific stages, whether you have a brain cancer, pancreatic cancer, ovarian cancer, blood cancer, there is a convergent evolution which makes every cancer have a couple of fundamental properties that they share. The first is that a cancer cell becomes immune to growth inhibitory signals from outside. So it becomes an autonomous body. Every cancer shares this property. And the second property is that a cancer cell remains immature. It does not mature. It does not differentiate. It does not become functional at any level. It's simply the simplest form of a cell that lives to divide. But in this form, it no longer remains a part of an organ. It becomes an organism. It starts behaving as a new species within the body. And by the way, as a teenager, I had become fascinated with cancer because I read a book in which it described cancer as the body as a state and cells as its citizens. And one of the things I read was that citizens have to follow rules. So in the body, cells have to, one of the rules is they have to follow is that they must remain in their organ of origin. In other words, liver cells need to stay in the liver. Pancreatic cells in the pancreas. Only in one condition, they literally walk out of their organ of origin and go find new homes, and that is cancer. So my thing was, what gives it this mobility? This is like an, you know, a cancer cell becomes something living inside our body, which treats our body as an adverse environment constantly and is trying to find new homes. And secondly, of course, the fact that it's an immortal cell. I mean, it just its only purpose is to divide into and live. I found those two things terribly fascinating. What causes immortality in a cancer cell? Because I figured, like, if we can unlock the secret of this immortality, we could unlock the secret of aging. Okay, this is a teenager thinking. And second, how do these cells become mobile? Based on some of this thinking constantly that I've been doing, I feel like some stress is present which causes abnormal behavior in cells. And I don't mean mental stress. I don't mean psychological stress. I mean stress in an organ. For example, in the liver, there's a hepatitis B virus infection. Suddenly, virus is killing lots of cells. So there's, you know, bone marrow starts sending blood cells to fight the infection, and a whole battleground is set up in the liver now with inflammatory responses from the body and the virus developing better and better, more efficient ways of killing cells. So the cells are getting a signal, fight or flight, either you're going to die or develop a strategy to survive. And in this situation, stressed cells can develop various strategies. So I decided to create stress in leukemia cells in the lab. And the way we did it is various methods. We CRISPRed in a mutation that can cause abnormal behavior. We gave chemotherapy to cells, induced hypoxia, caused nutritional deprivation. And what we saw was something really just shocking. Here are wild type cells growing in a dish. Once we introduced the CRISPRed in a mutation, we saw the sudden appearance of these very large cells. Didn't know what they are. Here are cells growing happily, and then we gave chemotherapy, and again, large cells appear. So any stress we gave led to the appearance of these large cells. We did all kinds of staining on these cells, trying to figure out what they are. And one of the things we saw was that they become polyploidal. These are wild-type cells, and these are the CRISPRed mutated cells. They become polyploidal. And in fact, some of them have up to 32N DNA. So it's crazy. One of the things I did is a lot of time lapse in the lab. And so we fixated the lens of our camera on one giant cell and started following it, and nothing happened to it for 3 days. And suddenly we saw the craziest thing. This cell starts giving birth to little cells. And now we have got this phenomenon over and over. My friend and colleague at MD Anderson, Jinsong Liu, calls it somatic cell pregnancy, which is very appropriate, by the way. So we have got this phenomenon of cells, these giant cells giving birth, little cells pinching out of it. Look at this one giant cell causing. And then after a few weeks, all we see in the lab petri dish is just the small cells, and the giant cells disappear. This is where we are diagnosing cancer. So basically, I'm telling you, we're missing all the early events involved in the initiation of cancer because no one bothers to look there. Everyone is busy taking these cells now, injecting them into mice, and then, you know, it's all, you know, all my criticism of this approach. So, but this was all in a petri dish in the lab. The question I had is, first of all, what are these giant cells? How come no one is talking about them? And there are, when I went to the literature, a lot of my colleagues had been noticing them for years and years. So first described by Virchow, polyploid giant cancer cells have been recognized for a century. Now, they're extremely rare in a primary tumor. So let's say you're looking at a section of a lung cancer or a brain cancer, and you'll see maybe one out of thousands of cells, one giant cell. So, however, now that we are doing liquid biopsies, which means we are taking blood from patients and looking through filtration techniques, we can capture these in bigger numbers. And so we saw that number increases post-therapy. They contribute to resistance and relapse. And recurrence is caused by them. So stress or chemotherapy, let's say, when we are trying to treat a cancer, we give chemotherapy, it kills most of those small cells which are there. To survive stress, I am saying that some of the cells fuse, or they undergo endoreplication, mitotic slippage. So they keep making DNA, but they don't undergo mitosis. So giant cells result with polyploidy. And so my question is, could this be the first cell as a result of stress? Based on all this, I proposed a different model that one stress cell joins with another stress cell. And this fusion leads to a polyploid giant cancer cell, or as it is called, polyaneuploid cancer cell. And now the nucleus keeps dividing, but the cell doesn't divide. So this becomes a giant polyploid cell. And with time, depolyploidization occurs, and these are the cells that have 2N DNA now, but aneuploid, of course, in most cases, and they are capable of all the things that cancer does. Now, when we come with any kind of treatment, we get rid of these small cells. But the giant cell survives. Why? Because it's the reason for coming into existence was just to withstand adverse environment and stress. And with time, it will be this giant cell which has survived, this mother cell, that causes recurrence. And so, if that is true, what can we do with these giant cells? First of all, I wanted to look in humans to see, can we catch any of these by size? So literally use a coffee filter technology. Take blood, pass it through a filter, giant cells will be trapped, blood cells smaller size go through. I started working with Patrizia Patrolini at, she was at Pasteur Institute. Her husband, Christian Brichot, was the president of the Pasteur Institute. Patrizia and I started working together 8 years ago. She has developed this technology, isolation by size of epithelial tumors, this ICE machine, which I've had in my lab for 7 years. And I started to pass blood from MDS patients through the filters, hoping that I can trap the first leukemia cell and diagnose acute leukemia developing these pre-leukemia patients before the bone marrow becomes filled with the cells, and it's impossible to treat them. And once we took 10 ml of blood, we pass it through the ISET machine and it goes through the filter and we can see what is trapped. We began to see immediately these giant cells. Now, this is a leukemia cell. Compare it to the size of this giant cell with multiple nuclei. See? So these are the leukemia cells. And then patient after patient, we saw how many nuclei are present, and these are the white blood cells in the blood compared to the size of the giant cells with multiple nuclei. Now I have done hundreds of patients. Always we find giant cells with the little cells coming out. It's just shocking how we missed this. You know, I was asking my friend Ken Pienta, who's the head of urologic oncology at Hopkins and has done tremendous amount of work on giant cells before me in solid tumors, in prostate cancer. I asked him, why do you think we have ignored all these things? So his answer was, because we have been taught to ignore them. We only look for something that we think should be there and we ignore everything else. So what about solid tumors? Well, they've been called by many different names. So I'm just going to show you some data on camels from solid tumors. Giant polynucleated cells have been found in every solid tumor examined, and now more than 5,000 patients with solid tumors have been studied. From the blood, this is a liquid biopsy, and they use 7.5 ml of blood, which is literally one big tablespoon of blood. That's it. You pass it through the filter. You look at the size of the white blood cells now. And now you look at the size of these giant cells, which have been captured from patients. They are called camels, cancer-associated macrophage-like cells, because they are expressing macrophage markers also. And now here are, on these 5,000 patients, a summary of all these cancers that 20 different types were studied. I'm showing you the top 10 most common solid tumors. And you can see breast cancer, 95% patients showed camels. Why 95% and why not 100%? Well, because we only use 7.5 ml of blood. If we had used 15 ml of blood, these are rare cells. Maybe everyone would have. But in every case, I mean, we found 100% in melanoma, 100% in kidney, 100% in liver. Another interesting thing is that changes in camels after treatment predicts treatment efficacy. And it's cancer agnostic, any type of cancer. If you don't find any camels after treatment in any type of cancer, the survival is beautiful. If you find camels, look at the survival, depending on size, shape, number of camels you find. So clearly there are giant cells in every solid tumor. Clearly these are associated with treatment outcome. I've told you giant cells are described for 200 years, giant cells found in both liquid and solid tumors. They increase in number after therapy. They're implicated in resistant, aggressive, metastatic disease, and they're associated with diagnosis, prognosis, progression-free survival, and overall survival. In my opinion, they are the best therapeutic targets. So last year, I held a summit at Columbia University and invited everybody working on giant cell field and cancer. MD Anderson Group, Johns Hopkins Group, Oregon Health Science Center Group, and ourselves. And for 2 days, we were locked up. We were debating the importance of giant cells. And my question was, are they good therapeutic targets or not? And every single person agreed that in order to cure cancer, we have to get rid of these cells. I'll just show you two patients now. We are nearing the end of my talk now. So here's a 54-year-old man, heavy smoker, doesn't have cancer yet. But when a liquid biopsy was done in 2009 on this patient, liquid biopsy means passing blood on the ISET machine, suddenly these giant cells began to appear. And this looked very much like an adenocarcinoma. Because they were tumor microemboli, they looked like adenocarcinoma cells along with the giant cells. But they kept doing CAT scans and PET scans. No tumor could be found. This patient was just at risk of cancer because he was a heavy smoker and had COPD. Until finally, 3 years later, CAT scan showed a tumor mass. This was completely resected. And for 11 years, the patient has now been completely cured. So there is an association of finding giant cells way before. This is one of the patients that I was directly involved with. Again, a healthy patient, non-smoker, completely healthy woman, never, no risk of cancer. So I always collect blood from healthy volunteers when I'm running patient samples on the machine. I give my blood every week as a normal control. And this woman's blood we also took and passed it as just a normal control back in 2017, and we began to see giant cells. Where is the tumor? Now, this is a perfectly healthy woman. So we started doing all kinds of things. But then she finally showed an abnormal pap smear. So I said, oh, it must be the cancer is in the cervix. It was in the endocervix way above. So that was removed. Indeed, it was a malignant cancer. And before, while she didn't have the surgery for 3 years, 4 years prior, every time we studied her, we found these giant cells. And then, so here's a summary. 2017, we found one giant cell. By 2019, we had circulating tumor microemboli 10. By 2020, so they kept increasing. Now we saw lots and lots of them until 2021, when the tumor was completely removed. And now for 2 years, we have not found a single giant cell. So I don't know if this is just associations. But clearly, in both liquid and solid tumors, I wanted to show you cases exist now that we can diagnose years before because of the presence of a giant cell, and two, that they disappear after cure. So this is just about the patients. Anyway, so the question is, how can we take these cells out? Well, they're tumor hybrid cells. So two different lineages have joined, fused together to form the first cell. So let's say here's a cell expressing an antigen A. It fuses with another cell expressing antigen B. Under stress, when they fuse, now the fused giant cell will have expression of both A and B. So basically, that's our challenge. It's a problem of numbers, that here's a cell expressing nothing. About 50 billion cells would express A, 50 billion normal cells would express B. But in cancer, a few thousand cells will now express A plus B, the first cell, the giant cell. This is the technical challenge. So first, we needed to have lots of cells to study, and giant cells from cancer patients are very rare. So what I did is we took HL60 cells, which are human leukemia cell line growing in vitro, and it does not express A or B antigen, which we have identified on the surface of giant cells. We used a lentivirus and forced it to some cells to express A, some express B, and some to express both A and B. So now, because this is present in vitro, we can use this cell line model. So when we develop a product to target A plus B, we have to show that that target against A plus B is not killing A, not killing B, only killing these cells. Because these are a lot of normal cells are expressing A, a lot of normal cells are expressing B in the body. Anyway, one of these technologies is the AND logic gate, the co-locker technology. And so there the idea is that you have a cell expressing antigen A, so you come in with an antibody to it, but then also the antibody contains a caged protein, a caged peptide here. Then there is another cell expressing antigen B, so you have an antibody that only binds to antigen B. And this contains the key that can open the lock. So when this antibody binds to a cell expressing A, nothing will happen. Binds to B, nothing will happen. But if there is a cell expressing both A and B, then the key will open the lock and this thing gets thrown out. And the beauty is that we can then catch it with a CAR T. We can cause destruction of this cell. In other words, these cells won't be killed. These cells won't be killed only when the two antigens are in very close proximity. Will this happen? So I hate CAR T because anyone who gives CAR T to patients will know how toxic they are. I really want to develop an ADC, which is a protein drug conjugate rather than a CAR T technology, or a T cell engager, a bispecific antibody, things like that. So another collaborative project I can think of is now, this is, by the way, so I want to develop this. We've been trying to develop this product for 3 years now, and we have not succeeded because of technical problems. One of the things I'm trying to do is see if we can somehow build a scaffolding protein here that will then be able to change the conformation so that we can lead to T cell engagement, things like that. So one collaborative project would be to predict novel proteins that result from fusion of the two cells of different lineages. Since we already know the two unique antigens on the hybrid cells, can AI predict protein-protein interactions? Can possible genome reorganization resulting from fusion and prediction of possible novel proteins from that? And I know some of Ayaz's work is related to protein interaction and prediction. So perhaps we could consider working in this area together also to identify novel targets. So coming back to the idea that I presented first and showed you that we are trying to develop a technology to target the giant cell. But then the idea is that the appearance of the giant cell is owed to some kind of stress. So I keep moving to earlier and earlier phases of cancer. I showed you all the work about pre-leukemia. I showed you work about the first cell, but the first cell appears due to stress also. Can we catch that stress? So based on that, we have looked at MDS patients who have pre-leukemia. Some developed leukemia within 3 years and some developed it after 6 years, basically. So there are two types of MDS patients, those who will die quickly, those who will be alive for 6 years and longer. And we can compare them to normals by doing multi-omics and then examining all the data by artificial intelligence to come up with some prognostic biomarker signature. As I said, Regeneron has already completed whole genome SNPs. We can use AI to predict survival and response to therapy. So I think there are many steps at which we can collaborate, and I hope afterwards, now that my time is done, we will have some question answers, and then perhaps we can stay back and talk about potential collaborations. Let me just end by going back to Andrew, where we started. The question I keep asking myself is, how many Andrews have to die before we wake up to realizing that this chasing after the last cell is causing too much harm? In another cruel twist of irony, Andrew's mom, Elena, called me recently and said now her best friend has developed the same exact cancer, glioblastoma, stage 4 that Andrew had. And then she said, Azra, but I told her that, listen, more than 5 years have gone by now since our Andrew died. Azra must have found some better treatment by now. And of course we haven't. We haven't made an iota of advance in treating glioblastoma multiforme. And year after year keeps going by, and Andrew after Andrew is dying. And we are just wringing our hands and not doing enough, I feel. So let me end by showing you a 2-minute video that Andrew's sister, who was 25 years old herself, made for her brother. So this talk and this work is dedicated to Andrew.
New York isn't New York without you, love. So far and a few blocks to be so low. And if I call you from First Avenue, we're the only in the city who can handle me. New love wasn't true. Back to you, love. So much for a home run with
Thank you very much, Azra, for that really insightful and eye-opening talk that you're giving there. I think it's really important, especially for us sort of researchers that end up spending a lot of time sat behind a desk, to actually get to that we need to, well, it's important for us to remember the sort of the real devastating effects that cancer has, this disease that we're all working on, has on patients sort of every day. So thank you very much for that. And with that, I'll open the floor to questions. Has anyone got any questions for us? Okay, then, well, I'll start then. So so obviously one of the main themes of your presentation and of your book has been in discovering the first cell and trying to improve treatment. So how do you think we can go about as actually trying to change the focus of, especially when applying for grants and writing papers, that we actually can try and change the overall shift, this sort of paradigm to focusing on the first cell?
So Adam, I'm a big fan of Thomas Kuhn, who in the 60s wrote a beautiful book called The Structure of Scientific Revolution. This book I read like every other year, at least. It's so wonderful. I mean, he made a very important point. You don't like the current paradigm, you're not happy with it. Show the success of your new paradigm, then it will shift. So my answer is, look, if we come up with a word processor, who's going to worry about the typewriter anymore? If we are really so convinced that the first cell could be curative, even for if we take it out, it can cure advanced cancers, well, then it's incumbent upon me to show the success of this paradigm, and then it will shift. It's the only way. Otherwise, if I go keep trying to change minds, it's never going to happen.
Thank you. I think we have a question from Sean on the left.
Hi, Azra. It's Sean here. I don't understand much about the biology, but I just had a question about, so if all the cancer cells are originating from the first cell, so how about as the cancer evolves and it becomes more heterogeneous, so there might be some further few targets as well coming up. So how do you target those as the cancer is evolving? So that's a bit I wanted to understand.
Yes. The data that we are developing, not just myself, but others working in this giant cell field, appears to indicate, Sean, that what is really happening in recurrence and evolution of cancer also happens due to fusion. It's not always that the small cells are mutating. So we do believe that if we take the culprit out, or we have a way to target the first cell at every, so let's imagine a two-phase approach to treatment. There is a patient who's like Andrew, presents with end-stage kind of cancer. We try to remove it by surgery, then we give chemotherapy, we give radiation therapy, immune therapy, whatever is the available treatment. And in many cases, we don't see any further evidence, even microscopic evidence of cancer, but then it will relentlessly return. And so I'm saying in the first phase, use the state-of-the-art treatments to kill every cancer cell we can, and then supplement it by coming in with an approach to target and take out the giant cells. And then see, can we delay recurrence at least for end stage cancer? And if that happens, then we can start moving to earlier stages of cancer. Yeah. But that's what I'm imagining. Now, there is no answer to the question you're asking, which can be definitive, because we just don't know until we do it.
Yeah, thanks.
Brilliant, thank you. I think we've got a question from Professor Lawrence Young online.
Hi there, thanks for that. Hi Azra. So I don't really understand this giant cell scenario, because as far as I know, there's no intrinsic ability of those giant cells to actually divide, is there? And what's the relationship between these giant cells and, say, cancer stem cells, which we know is another important aspect of the cancer theory, where you have cells that are actually very slowly dividing, seem to be unaffected by conventional chemo radiotherapeutic approaches. So what's the relationship between giant cells and cancer stem cells? And is it true that these giant cells really do not have an intrinsic ability to proliferate?
Both good questions, Larry or Lawrence. So first of all, we have shown these giant cells dividing because I showed you the chromosomes in them. So they are undergoing mitosis.
That's from human samples, is it not from K562?
No, they are from K562. Human cells, we just don't have enough to follow them. Yeah. However, at MD Anderson, Jinsong Liu isolated giant cells from primary ovarian cancer and injected them in mice, and they initiated a whole new tumor. So this is all published work. So whether they divide or not, we don't know, but clearly they increase in number after chemotherapy. We suddenly see appearance of a lot of giant cells. Have we caught them in humans undergoing mitosis? I am not sure. I haven't in humans because I have too few giant cells and they're caught on these filters. So mitotic cells wouldn't be caught properly. They would get destroyed. Then your second question about stem cells. Yeah, that whole concept of stem cell exists. And in leukemias, I've been trying to study cancer stem cells in leukemia stem cells for like 100 years. I mean, that's how I began my career. And today, even for the last 30 years, I keep separating CD34 positive, 38 negative, lineage negative cells, which we think are the earliest stem cells, the few of them that are there. But no treatment has been developed to target them, take them out and show it can be curative. I mean, I really still to this day don't understand the concept of these stem cells well at all. We just invited John Dick from Toronto.
Yeah.
To come and spend 2 days with us. Mm. I spent a lot of time with him just 2 months ago. Mm. We had invited him to Colombia because, of course, what you're saying is what we have been doing, all of us, for all this time. And it's led to nothing in terms of treatment. There's a lot of great understanding of biology. Don't get me wrong. Mm. I love John Dick's work. I think he's a fabulous scientist. And I mean, that's why we work with him and invite him and all of them. But thing is that it's benefited very few patients.
Mm-hmm. On that score, though, Azra, either I'm too optimistic or you're too pessimistic. I look back at data now in terms of having worked in the oncology field for 40 years myself now, and think about if we look at, say, for instance, in the UK, cancer survival has more or less, well, it's doubled since I've been working in cancer.
Yeah.
Particularly in certain cancers like breast cancer. Now, I know that is a lot of that is about early diagnosis and the enormous impact of mammography. It's also about better treatments for breast cancer, including, you know, everything we know about HER2 and targeted therapies. And then we also have, obviously, the whole explosion of immune checkpoint inhibition and the whole immunotherapy area, which is, I know, again, you know, perhaps it's over-egged a bit, but nevertheless, in certain patients, we're seeing some remarkable effects of immune checkpoint inhibitor. I know there's also the downside in terms of side effects, etc., and that's true for all cancer therapy. But I just wondered when you started whether you were being a bit perhaps too pessimistic about the future.
I am, because the cancers I'm treating have only early detection will help them. Right. No amount of bone marrow transplants or T cell therapies or checkpoint inhibitors are helping them, or stem cell therapies. I've been in it for 35 plus years treating AML. So you're right, maybe I'm too pessimistic, and welcome to you to continue doing what you're doing. I'm not
it might vary independent on what where you specialize, I suppose. I mean, I do a lot of work in head and neck cancer, and we've seen some remarkable improvements there. And obviously we have the whole issue around circulating tumor DNA, and there's a big trial going on in the NHS at the moment in the UK, looking at using that as a potential for early diagnosis of you know, lung cancer, pancreatic cancer, the cancers that are very difficult to treat. So I'm slightly more optimistic, although I also appreciate exactly what you're saying, that there's been this massive investment in basic cancer pathology and understanding, and yet so little of that does actually translate even now into real patient benefit.
So in the interest of full disclosure, I am on the board of GRAIL. I'm very much aware. Sir Kumar.
Yeah.
He's very much aware.
Harpal Kumar.
We just had a board meeting. In fact, I'm very much aware of the data, and I keep scolding them also, because think of it, Lawrence. Think of it. GRAIL at the moment, using methylation patterns of cell-free DNA, they've come a long way. And we have an ASCO abstract. They're studying the entire tissue repository, by the way, for the methylation profile that we can come up with a signature. But at the moment, for solid tumors, using methylation profiling of cell-free DNA from the blood, they can diagnose only 29% of stage one. So they're missing 71% of the earliest cancer, stage one. Yes, they can detect 100% of stage four, but you don't have to be a weatherman to see it's raining outside. I don't need anyone to tell me that this person has stage four. What about stage one? You're detecting 29%. So their answer is always to me, well, we are detecting undetectable cancers that, you know, cancers that are not being screened for, even like ovarian cancer or pancreatic cancer, no screen for it, but we can detect them, some of them. Yes, and that's why I support them. That's why I continue to serve on the board. Otherwise, I don't have that kind of time. I would have resigned a long time ago. But also the important thing about them, you see, they started by looking at cell-free DNA when Rick Klausner, who's a good friend, started the company from Illumina.
Yep.
It was because he found cell-free DNA from fetal, maternal blood, and they were looking at fetal cell-free DNA. But they found mutations and said, okay, these mutations could probably now predict, you know, if the person has cancer. But then it couldn't predict what is the tissue of origin if you found a mutated piece of cell-free DNA. Then they developed a methylation profile. Once they trained their platform on the methylation profiles, do you know, Lawrence, that GRAIL no longer needs to see a mutated piece of DNA? Their platform is so good now, their AI platform, that they can simply look at a piece of DNA and by the methylation pattern on it, 100% accuracy, they can say if it's malignant piece of DNA or not. Can you believe?
Amazing.
80,000, only 80,000 methylation markers. That's it, even though their depth is much more. I'm very much aware of everything that's going on because I spent last 40 years thinking of nothing else but cancer.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Azra. We've also got a few questions from Nasser over here. So,
thank you very much, Azra. That was a fascinating talk. I have three questions. First of all, you said that your hypothesis, I think, if I understood it correctly, the main hypothesis is that it's the stress that causes abnormal behavior in cells and hence the genesis of these giant cells, if I understood it correctly. What other stress factors have you looked at or do you think should be looked at? And then my second question is, if it's all about...
Let me answer one at a time or I'll forget your first question by the time you need reach the third. So the answer is very simple, Nasir. I don't know what stress to look for, but I think if we just look at this serum or plasma from patients who have pre-leukemia, who have no leukemia. So I have hundreds and thousands of samples from normal individuals from pre-leukemia and leukemia. We look at stress markers, just markers of by metabolomics and proteomics to see how these differ from normal to pre-leukemia to acute leukemia. And then we can try to see whether the same stress markers we are finding that we detect in liquid tumors, are they the same in solid tumors? So that's the answer to your first question. Mm-hmm. We don't have to look for an actual stress, just the markers.
Yeah, absolutely. My question was actually more towards more generic type of cell stress markers. And you think that all the ones that you might find...
We won't find anything more in genomics. So all the low-hanging fruit has been picked.
Okay. You mentioned, for example, Hep C as a virus that could induce stress and lead to the genesis of the giant cell and hence the genesis of cancer. I was wondering if there are any other kind of stress factors, not necessarily stress markers.
Yeah, exposure to toxins is one. Radiation is another. Anything that's killing cells, autoimmune disease, chronic inflammatory diseases of any sort for whatever reason, doesn't have to be pathogen induced. There can be inflammation induced for other reasons. So yeah, all those conditions that cause chronic stress.
Okay, great. So my second question was going to be, should we change our paradigm for early diagnosis screening? Should we be looking when we are doing screening in pap smears and, you know, any kind of biopsies, colon biopsies and whatever, should we be looking for giant cells as well as tumor cells?
I think not immediately till we prove the paradigm. The burden is on me and others working in this area that you got to take us seriously. Right now, you got to continue doing what you're doing. I'm doing what I'm doing with my patients also.
That was going to be my next question. In fact, how do you go to your 30, 40 patients that you see on a weekly basis and tell them how you can help them? Because as Laura said, you started off a bit pessimistically at the beginning. And fair enough, I totally understand the basis for that. But what do you say to your patients on the basis of your findings and what you know in terms of how you can help them?
First of all, let me say that if I developed acute myeloid leukemia today, the disease I've been unsuccessfully treating for so many years, I would take the same treatment because that's all that's available. So what do I have to lose? It might work, even if there's a 1 in 1,000,000 chance, I'll take it. So I'm no different than anyone else. Second, how do I deal with my patients? This is why I wrote the whole book. And it's, if you haven't had a chance to read it, please order your free copy on my website and read it. Because this is all I talk about, is what I do with patients when the whole thing is so frustrating. But you can't take away hope from patients. You can't break their spirit. And there's always this statistical thing that 30% can respond. But at what cost to the other 70% who have not responded? So I'm thinking for the future constantly, trying to improve the outcome for the future. But for the present, we use what we have. It's a good question, Nasir. I can see how, just because I'm so critical of everything, people think I'm a naysayer and I must be painting the worst doom and gloom picture. No, my clinics are the happiest clinics. People are, because whatever time they have left, we have to make the most of it. So please read my book and you'll see.
Definitely will. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We've got a couple of questions online. So I'll start with we've got a question from Hania Mahmood, who said, excellent and very inspiring talk. Thank you. I'm an oral surgeon based in the UK. Some of the earliest signs of chronic anemia and underlying leukemia and manifest orally. Now I've seen hematological malignancies detected through oral diseases alone. Do you dentally screen patients involved in your research? And would there be any benefit in using oral features as part of development of risk prediction models?
Wow, that's wonderful. No, I haven't done it or thought of that. Although I have had many patients who are dentists who claim that they develop it because they have developed MDS because exposure to material that we're using to for fillings and things like that. And so their mouths were always involved in this. But I didn't know that you can diagnose chronic anemia from oral conditions. That's fantastic. I haven't thought of it and not done it.
Brilliant, thank you. And we've also got a question from Matteo Pozzi online. He was said, thanks Azra for this inspiring talk. Did you think about also how to structure a screening protocol given that both high and low risk person might have giant cells circulating? Did you think about structuring a screening protocol,
Yes, brilliant question. Yes, I've thought a lot about it. In fact, 4 years ago, I put together something called an oncology think tank. And in this think tank, I recruited leaders from Harvard, MD Anderson, Johns Hopkins, University of Chicago, Northwestern, Columbia, Johns Hopkins, the top seven institutions in the country, leaders from everywhere. And we debated this question about how do we screen patients for early detection. And 2 years ago, I published a paper in Scientific American. I'm the lead author with 30 authors following from all these institutions. And we reached the conclusion that we have to find cancer way before stage one. So how should we do it? How should we screen people? Obviously, we have to then start screening people. If we want to find the first cell, people who are at high risk of developing cancer, see if we can find the first cell in those patients, and does that first cell, is it always associated with development of a malignancy or not? So the way we decided to do it was identify a population of individuals who are at high risk of getting cancer. Who are these individuals? So I don't want anyone to get anxious, but those individuals are anyone who has survived a cancer is at risk for another. Why do I say it? If you look at newly diagnosed cancer patients, do you know 1 in 5 new cancers appear in a cancer survivor? So a cancer survivor's risk is not very high at an individual level. If you have had prostate cancer, for example, and you got cured of it, your risk of developing a second malignancy, not recurrence of prostate cancer, a second malignancy is only 13% higher than that of a person who has never had cancer. But if you look at newly diagnosed cancers, then 20% are in a cancer survivor. So based on that, I said, wow, cancer survivors are coming to all our institutions for follow-up regularly. Why not just draw their blood and look for giant cells? So we started this program called FIX, First Cell Center for Cancer Survivors. And today at Columbia University, we are getting 10 cancer survivors a day, and we are saving samples on them and running them through the filters. So we are saving blood, saliva, urine, feces, hair, and nails on cancer survivors and banking them and running the blood and urine through the filters. And with time, we'll have thousands of these. In a year or two, people start developing second cancers. And now we go back and look at the filters and all the plasma and serum and everything we have saved. And that's how we are planning to develop the screening technology for first cell detection. I hope that answers you.
Yeah, that really clears it up. Thank you very much. We've also got a question from Dan, from one of our PhD students in our lab. So Dan said, hi, I'm a student in the sales lab. I'm sorry for asking a dumb question, but do you have a chance to see what would happen if we remove all giant cells in late stage cancer patients? Is there any mouse models for this, for instance?
No. I don't do mouse studies.
Brilliant, thank you. Oh, we've got a question online as well from Buzz.
Hi there, it's Brendan Chan. I'm one of the consultants to pathologists. I was wondering, the level of data that you're talking about is that would be required, Is it more along the lines of long-term follow-up, a la kind of like the Framingham study that was done on cardiovascular patients? Because in that scenario is really the only way you're ever going to be able to truly look for the smallest, earliest signs of cancer. And the only way we're going to know this is by retrospectively moving. In the research that I've been trying to influence has been along the same lines as you, but I've never come across your work, which was, I get told time and time again, largely by computer scientists, that pathologists are good ground truths. But I feel ashamed to admit that I really don't think I am. But what level of research body are you looking for to say I will have enough data? Because by the sounds of it, the data you already have may be enough to do some work, particularly with AI, because AI's strongest suit is actually looking for features which humans, depending on the type of AI, but ones that that humans have actually overlooked. If you already have good tabulated clinical data, you have the other modalities of diagnostics, namely blood films, bone marrow biopsies with morphology mm-hmm. reports, and if there is the potential to even work upon the data that you already have to develop a very large, multifaceted AI model. And provided you could plug in all your relevant endpoints, including treatment outcome data, you would have a very, very powerful model. And that's ultimately what you need. And if that was able to then start telling you, hey, these are the people who, this small change in the blood film of these cells are the multinucleates that you're looking for. What I'm trying to say is, well done. It's nice to see somebody else is working or looking into these types of things. But with the data you have, what could you do with the Warwick or the TIA Center? Because that's largely where their strength is, image analysis of the data you have.
Buzz, that was excellent. That's exactly what I need, the kind of guidance. I have all these data. This is what I proposed earlier, collaborative things that we shouldn't have to do these fancy elaborate tests anymore. AI should be able to take a drop of blood and tell us what are the stress, is this person stressed or not, based on all the information that we have. And we have access to, through medical records, to electronic medical records, to everything you could ask for, plus pathology slides, plus images, everything is available. It's a matter of finding the money to do the work together.
Brilliant. Well, thank you very much for the question, Buzz, and thank you for the answers, Azra. So I think with that, if we carry on, if we end our actual seminar and move on to the actual discussion about the collaboration opportunities. So for this, I'll turn off the recording and everyone's still okay to stay a bit longer, aren't they? So.
Thank you, Adam. Azra, so I've been trying to translate in my head what the word tahayyur means. I think it means blown away after your talk, anyways. So thank you for your talk. I really enjoyed it. I'm going to listen to it again. There are some really nice directions. I've got a couple of questions that that came up during the discussion. So one of them was about this oral, whether there's anything in the dentistry that can tell us about these. So one dear friend of mine passed away with aplastic anemia. And one of the first symptoms actually appeared was in the teeth, so the gum bleeding and those kind of stuff. So maybe there is something that needs to be investigated further. But that's just a comment I had. But
wait, Fayaz. I have saliva samples on every patient. 60,000 I'm talking about, saliva samples on everyone. So we have the ability to look for stress markers there.
Okay.